Today's topic of discussion is tissue nematodes. By the end of this session, you should be able to enlist and describe important tissue nematodes, describe their vectors, characteristic features, including the lab diagnosis of these tissue nematodes. So we are in metazoa category again, and you already know some of the intestinal nematodes, but we are going to just discuss the tissue nematodes today. The disease produced by these tissue nematodes is called as lymphatic filariasis because it is going to affect the lymphatic system. So we have Fucreria bancrofti, Brugia malai, Onchocerca volvulus, and Loa. Now let's talk about the morphology of tissue nematodes. There is an adult form and there is an immature larvae, which is also known as microfilary. Let's first have a look at the morphology of adult worm. It is thread-like, it is long, and it resides in subcutaneous tissue and in lymphatics. Then is the microfilarial form. Now, in case of microfilarial form, most of these tissue nematodes will have sheath in which the larva can move forwards and backwards, but there are some tissue nematodes where you would not find any sheath. And the nuclei are arranged as a column and they extend from head till tail region. Some of these nuclei would be present near the tip of the tail, whereas some tissue nematodes would have no nuclei in the tip of the tail. And these microfilarial forms can live only in lymphatics. However, in case of Onchocerca volvulus, they are present in skin. Now please remember, these tissue nematodes are viviparous, which means that they can give rise to live young, which has developed inside the body of these nematodes. So there is a separate male and female, whereas the intestinal nematodes, for instance, Ascaris lumbricoides, Entrobius vermicularis, all of these are oviparous, which means that they produce eggs or ova. So you should be familiar with the names of the tissue nematodes along with their corresponding vector. So in case of Fucreria bancrofti and Brugia malai, we have mosquito with either Culex, Aedes, or Anopheles, and I think this should refresh your memory regarding the female Anopheles mosquito, which is responsible for producing malaria. Okay, in case of Onchocerca volvulus and Loa, we have fly. It is black fly in case of Onchocerca volvulus, deer or mango fly in case of Loa. Now let's quickly go through the life cycle of all of these tissue nematodes. Okay, the life cycle is going to start with the bite of either the fly or mosquito. It depends which is the tissue nematode. And the humans are the definitive host, the mosquito or fly is the intermediate host. So once there is a bite of either mosquito or fly, the larvae are going to enter into humans. And this is the third stage larvae. So they are going to mature and they will form the adult worms. There is a separate male and female, and they would give rise to microfilary, which is the larval form. So there would be no overproduction. Now, in case of fly or mosquito, there is intake of these larval forms during blood sucking process, and these microfilaria are going to move to thoracic muscles. They would undergo various developmental stages from first stage to second stage larvae, and finally the third stage larvae, which is the final product, and this is going to reach to the mouth parts of the fly or mosquito, and again they would be bite and the cycle would be repeated. Now if you talk about the Bucreria, Bancrofti and Brugia malai. First, we need to understand the pathogenesis of these two tissue nematodes. There is an inflammatory damage by the adult worm. There is lymphatic vessels occlusion, which can result in edema. So the lymph nodes are enlarged, firm and fibrotic. So basically the lymphatic vessels are either partially or completely blocked by these thrombi or masses of dead worms, and there is granulomatous reaction. And there are three main stages. The first one is the asymptomatic microfilariemic stage, then is the acute phase or acute stage, and the last one is the chronic stage. Now, in case of acute phase, there can be filarial fever, which can go up to, let's say, 103 degrees Fahrenheit or even more than this. Then is acute lymphangitis. Now, in case of acute lymphangitis, there is inflammation of the walls of lymphatic vessels, and you can see this streak, this erythematous streak in the arm. And then is acute lymphadenitis condition. Now, in this condition, there is inflammation or enlargement of a lymph node. Now, in case of chronic disease, hydrocele. It is a condition in which there is accumulation of fluid around the testicle, that is inside scrotum, and this can be as a result of plugged inguinal lymphatic system caused by repeated chronic infection of Bucreria bancrofti or Brugia malai, two mosquito-borne parasites of Africa and Southeast Asia. This condition can also be as a part of more diffuse sequelae, commonly referred to as elephantiasis. This is a condition characterized by gross enlargement of any area of the body, especially limbs, and can also commonly affect the external genitals. So this is caused by obstruction of the lymphatic system, which results in accumulation of a fluid called lymph in the affected areas. So this is also elephantiasis condition. Now, if you remember from the schistosoma lecture, I had talked about the hematuria, which is blood in urine. Now, there is another condition which is called as chylurea, which means there is chyle in urine, and this is because of the blocked lymphatic channels. They can open up into kidney, hilum or ureter, or probably the bladder, and this chyle can leak into the urethral system, resulting in milky white urine. Now, if you refresh your physiology knowledge regarding chyle, it is a milky fluid which consists of lymph and emulsified fats, you can say free fatty acids. It is formed in the small intestine and it consists of products which are formed during the digestion of fatty foods, and it is taken up by the lymph vessels, which are known as lacteals. There are a few words about the Bucreria bancrofti tropical pulmonary eosinophilia, which is an immediate hypersensitivity reaction. This can cause cough, wheezing at night, and this is by the microfilariae of Bucreria bancrofti. Now let's start with another tissue nematode, which is Onchocerca volvulus, also known as blinding worm. Just before discussing the clinical features, the pathogenesis of Onchocerca volvulus involves inflammation in the subcutaneous tissues, which can actually result in itchy papules or nodules. And this is in response to filarial proteins, and it can even reach eye. So what are the clinical features? There is an acute change and there can also be chronic change. Now, in case of acute change, there can be itching, features like enlarged lymph nodes. In chronic change, there is thickening and scaling of skin with itching or probably dryness of skin. They can be dermatitis, and this is called as lizard skin. Similarly, loss of subcutaneous elastic fibers can lead to hanging rhoen. They can be again enlargement of the limbs, the condition which is known as elephantiasis, or if the optic nerve is involved, it can lead to blindness, and that is why it is also known as blinding worm. Now, another tissue nematode which is called as Loa Loa or IRO. This is responsible for producing a disease which is called as loiasis. Its pathogenesis is very simple. There is no inflammation, there is just hypersensitivity reaction, there is no blindness but pain in eyes. So you can have localized pain or itching with Kallebaut swellings, which are non-erythematous subcutaneous swellings. And they can be a very disconcerting event. You can just at times find adult worm crawling across the conjunctiva. Okay, now let's have a quick look at the lab diagnosis of all of these tissue nematodes. So you can find the larval form in the peripheral blood, and the periodicity is obviously very important. So you need to be careful when you are collecting the blood, especially regarding the timings. So the nocturnal periodicity, which means that these microfilari come in blood during night time, so this is called as nocturnal periodicity. So Bucleria bancrofti, Bruggia mellii, they come during night time. And the Loa Loa has diurnal periodicity, which means they come in blood during daytime. Then there are various serological tests like ELISA, immunochromatography test, fluorescent antibody test, complement fixation test, for the Bucleria bancrofti and Onchocerca volvulus. Please remember, the Onchocerca volvulus remains in skin, so it would not be found in blood. So that's how you can go for biopsy of the skin, or you can also go for wet slide preparation. So there is a test that you can perform, and that is by finding the adult worms and nodules by placing piece of skin with drop of water on a slide and examine this under high power, or by observing microfilari in the eye through a slit lamp. Then is a skin test which is called as Mazotti's test. Once you treat this Onchocerca volvulus with diethyl carbamazine, which is the drug for treatment, there is formation of a pruritic rash or itchy rash, and this is because of response of these dead microfilari which are killed by this drug. And you can also find eosinophilia, an increased number of eosinophils in parasitic infections.